So I first like to make clear the fact that my slides heavily rely on slides of a talk by Stephen Morris. And so as you said, I'm not a specialist of global games. So what I want to do today is try to tell you what I understand of the very basic idea of the global game structures. So where the main result comes from. So it will be an informal presentation, so not a game theoretical one. In three parts, first I'd like to emphasize the role played by common knowledge to help coordination, and then how it applies to global games, and so global games that appear as a tractable class of games to handle higher order beliefs. And then to show the recent paper by Maurice Echin that is an example of a global game about adverse selection on financial markets. So first, about coordination and common knowledge. So back to the definition of common knowledge given by Lewis in 69. Well, he defined common knowledge, so I guess most of you know, everyone knows this, that a proposition P is true, is common knowledge whenever it is true, whenever everyone knows that it is true, everyone knows that everyone that it is true, and so on up to infinity. And he used common knowledge to explain stability of conventions and to emphasize that common knowledge are needed to sustain coordination of agents on a particular behavior. So what is a convention? Roughly speaking, it is a behavior that is persistently observed. So for example, the fact that we drive right or we drive left. And take the example of language. So language, it is well known that the meaning of a word is a convention. And that, for example, we use the word cat to refer to a cat and dog to refer to a dog, but we might do the opposite. And what, so the point made by Lewis was not to say that it was a convention, which is well known again, but to explain how this convention can emerge and persist through common knowledge. And so, if we keep going with the example of the cat and the dog, think of a conversation that we can have, you and me, speaking about cats. So it is not enough that we both use the word cat to refer to a cat. We must also both know that the other is using the word cat to refer to a cat. And still, this is not enough. Because suppose that I use the word cat to refer to a cat, and I think that you use the word cat to refer to a cat. So the first order beliefs are okay, because I think that that I know what you are doing. But the next step is not okay, it's not right, because I think that you think that I use the word cat to refer to a dog. So my belief about your belief are that I use cat to refer to a dog. And in this case, I don't expect to be understood if I say the cat is on the map. Because I will think that when you hear me saying cat, I am speaking about a dog. And so if you iterate this argument, you understand that to have a successful conversation, we need common knowledge of meaning of the words. So the fact that we both use cat to refer to a cat, that we both know that one is true, that we both know that two is true, and so on up to infinity. And the idea is that coordination on a convention requires common knowledge that everyone is following this behavior, so is following the convention. And to put this in more game theoretical world, it means that what Lewis had in mind was to say that to explain convention as a Nash equilibrium in a coordination game. So what I will do this morning is to use this simple example of a coordination game that. So that's at least from Carlson and Van Damme in 1993. So think of an investment game. I give the interpretation of an investment game, but you might think as another interpretation. The idea that we have two players, so I restrict to two players to keep things simple. We have two actions, invest or not invest. On the payoff structure, I will not give you precise payoff. I just want to say that the payoff structure is such that if the over player invests, I want to invest. If the over player does not invest, I don't want to invest. So you have two equilibria in this game, in pure strategies, the fact that both players invest and the fact that no player invests. And this is typical of coordination games. You have multiple equilibria. And you can reinterpret this game by saying that instead of investing or not investing, this is attacking or not attacking in a speculative attack, or not withdraw the money or withdraw the money from the bank if you think of a bank run model. And now consider that payoff depends on fundamental variables, so say theta, and that we have two possible cases. Either the fundamentals are good, and so the payoff in this case, we say that the payoff are as above, you have two equilibria, or the fundamentals are bad. And in this case, the payoff are such that not invest is a dominant action. And so you have a unique equilibrium where no one invests and where there is no true coordination problem because you don't have to care about what the other does to know that you have to invest. So high fundamentals give two equilibrium, so it's consistent with two equilibrium. Low fundamentals is consistent with only one equilibrium when these fundamentals are common knowledge. And if we think a little bit more about this, when do you have to invest? Two conditions are needed. The first one is that you need high fundamental, and the second one is that the action of the other player is to invest. Now, here, the bottom of the slide is to stress the fact that common knowledge of the fact that fundamentals are high, so high fundamentals mean here that they are larger than theta star, than the threshold theta star. This common knowledge makes that the action invest can be taken in equilibrium. And to understand this, we can define the whole infinite hierarchy of beliefs, consistent with the fact that everyone invests. Because, for example, you know that player one invests because he knows that fundamentals are high and that the other invests. This is the starting point of the game. And if you iterate this, the fact that player J invests, it is due to the fact that himself, player J, knows that the fundamentals are high and that the other player is investing. So this is point two. Player I knows that player J knows that theta is high and player I invests. And then you can iterate. Player I knows that player J knows that player I knows that theta is high enough, and so on up to infinity. So what?
Isn't 1 and 2 enough?
Yes. So you are. What I say here is that this is consistent with common knowledge, with. A common knowledge of the action being played.
2 says player I knows that J knows that I invests, but that only follows then from assumption 3.
And so maybe this comes to your question. What about the necessity of common knowledge of the fact that theta are high enough? The idea is that, so here I will not give a very game theoretically precise assessment. The fact that theta is high enough is somewhat necessary to sustain the fact that everyone invests is an equilibrium outcome, because, and this follows the first example of the language, if I know that theta are high enough, but I don't know whether the other knows that theta is high enough, then I cannot be sure that the other is going to invest, and so I cannot be sure that I must invest. And so it may not be exactly necessary, this common knowledge, because you still decide to invest even when you are not totally certain that the other is going to invest and that fundamentals are high enough. And so, say my answer to your point will be to say that what is needed here is an appropriate definition of not totally certain, and this will be the point made in the further slides. So, but to summarize this, the general idea developed in the example is that some common knowledge of fundamentals is required to coordinate on a risky action, What I call here a risky action is an action that you play when you know that an event, a certain event on fundamental is true, and that you know that everyone is playing the other action. So you know to, you need to know something about others' behavior to be sure that playing the risky action is optimal. In this case, action A occurs at an equilibrium action when the event E about the fundamental is common knowledge. And note that this is only an existence result. I'm only claiming here that common knowledge of the event E allows for the coordination and the risky action, but this is not a uniqueness result. Other outcomes may be consistent with the same common knowledge of the same event on the fundamentals. In the case, in the investment game, when fundamentals are high, you may both have an equilibrium where everyone invests or an equilibrium where no one invests. So just a remark about common knowledge. Common knowledge has been defined by an infinite number of properties, and so it may seem very difficult to attain common knowledge or something, because it may seem it's difficult to have the fact that an infinite number of properties are true. But there is an alternative characterization that makes more simple the fact that a proposition is common knowledge. So this is a characterization through public event. A public event is an event that is known to everyone whenever it is true. And public events, so roughly speaking, public events are common knowledge events. So to make something common knowledge, you just have to claim it publicly. Because when you claim it publicly, at the very time where you tell that that I have a pink shirt, for example, I am telling that every of you hears the fact that I have a pink shirt, and so every of you see that everyone is hearing the fact that I have a pink shirt, and so on up to infinity. Now we come to approximate common knowledge. So basically what I will do here is to say the same thing as previously, but claiming that this holds true when you have something which is not exactly common knowledge, but something which is called common P belief, with the probability P being high enough. And so due the definition of common P belief being due to Manderer and Samet in 1989, so an event is common p-belief whenever, so you don't say that it is true, that everyone knows that it is true, but now you say that everyone believes the event with a probability at least p, and then everyone believes with probability at least p that everyone believes it with probability at least p, and so on to infinity. So the statement I know is replaced by the statement I believe with a large enough probability. And notice that the fact that an event is common P belief does not imply that this event is true. And this concept appears to be helpful to investigate equilibrium outcomes in coordination games. Before I turn to this question, just notice the fact that we may characterize common P belief events through almost public information. So as a parallel to what I said about the link between common knowledge events and public events. So first define a p-public event, so the fact that something is approximately public. A p-public event is such that whenever it is true, everyone p believes it, so everyone believes it with a probability at least p. So it means that when a p-public event occurs, it is common p-belief. And an event is common p-belief when it is p-public that everyone believes it with probability at least p. So it means that to make something common P belief, I have to say approximately publicly the fact that everyone believes it with a large probability. And so if I tell this with some noise so that you hear it more or less, so if I tell the fact that an event is common P belief, then with some noise, then it means that you, most of you will hear that I've told this, and that I've told this in such a way that probably everyone here has heard, maybe not certainly, but with a large probability, the fact that I told this, and so on up to infinity. So you can define the whole hierarchy of beliefs that characterize common P beliefs. So common knowledge events are public events. Commonly P-belief events are approximately public events. So now back to the question of coordination, now relying on approximate common knowledge, back to the two-player investment game. Now we relax the idea that the fundamental theta is common knowledge, and we say, we notice that a player will invest when he believes with a large enough probability, called P this probability, the fact that the fundamentals are high and that the other is investing. So it is not necessary to know with certainty what others are doing. I am in a game where I have to choose between two actions, even action invest or not invest. If I think with probability large enough that the factors that make action invest optimal are present, I will play the action invest. And so now what I do is simply to iterate this property. And you just have to be careful how to state the infinity hierarchy of beliefs. So first start with the idea that every player invests when he believes with a probability P, so he P believes, that fundamentals are high, and that the other is investing. But the other is investing if he P believes that the fundamentals are high and that the first player, player I, invests. And so the next point will be to add one more step to this. Player I invests when he P believes that fundamentals are high enough, and then the other P believes that the fundamentals are high enough, and that player I P believes himself that fundamentals are high enough, and that player G P believes. And you can do this, iterate this to infinity. And if you iterate this to infinity, you write simply the definition of the fact that there is common key belief that the fundamentals are high enough. And so what is written on this slide is that the outcome everyone invests can occur, so it's consistent with common key belief of the fact that fundamentals are high, consistent meaning that this is sustained by the whole hierarchy of beliefs. And so the direct implication of this is that there will be, so in a Bayesian game, where fundamentals are not common knowledge, there will be an equilibrium where in every state of nature where theta, the fact that fundamentals are high is common p-belief, so whenever this event is common p-belief, the equilibrium action will be to invest. So here's so summing up, the idea is that in a Bayesian game, you observe, so you have an equilibrium where you observe the fact that everyone is playing invest whenever the right event is common p-belief. Here, we can say that the converse implication is true as well. Why? Because, so, to understand that it is not possible to observe the fact that everyone invests at a state where the fact that fundamentals are high is not common p belief. For example, so just imagine that the sequence of higher order belief is broken at some stage. So to keep things simple, imagine that it is broken at the very beginning. Consider that I believe with a small probability that you believe with probability at least p that theta is high enough is true. So this is my second order belief, my belief about your belief. And these beliefs are such that I cannot invest. Why? Because I know from the definition of the game that you invest only if you put probability high enough of the fact that the fundamentals are high. But my, yes?
So you say believe
with
a small probability P.
Okay, it's a typo. Just P prime, yes, thank you. Sorry? No, it's, you're right here, this is, with a small probability, no, just, I believe with a small probability, so any probability, I believe with probability 1/10, imagine that my P, imagine that the P here is large, is 3/4, for example. And now imagine that I believe with a probability smaller than 3/4, so probability 1/10, for example, the fact that you believe with probability at least 3/4, that theta, high theta is true. So it means the belief required to invest is the P. the fact that I need to have a high probability of high fundamentals. And the point here is that I put only a small probability, very small one, about the fact that you have the right belief. Since I know that you invest only if you have what I just called the right belief, so large probability P on high fundamentals, what is my belief about what you are going to do, consistent with the fact that I put a small probability on the fact that you have the right belief on the high fundamentals, my belief will be that I put only a small probability, so I cannot put a probability larger than P, that you are going to invest. And if I only put a small probability on the fact that you are going to invest, I don't invest. So here, what we have is that if at some stage the infinite hierarchy of belief of, so sustaining common P belief of the fact that fundamentals are high, if at some stage this is broken, this sequence is broken, then as a result, someone is not investing. And so just to summarize this, the coordination of a risky action requires the most public information. So this is a general idea. So a most public information being equivalent, so roughly speaking, to approximate common knowledge, to common P belief. So in general, the idea was consider a Bayesian game where there is an action A that everyone plays whenever, so if and only if he believes with a probability large enough, so say at least P, that two things are true. First, a certain event E about fundamentals is true, and second, everyone else plays the action A. And what I have illustrated with the simple investment game is that the action A at an equilibrium of the Bayesian game will be played in a certain state of nature if and only if the event E about fundamentals in this state of nature is common P belief. And a straight interpretation of this is that the lack of common knowledge about fundamentals breaks down coordination on the risky action. And so, it emphasizes the role of higher order belief. So appropriate higher order belief are required to sustain the risky outcome. So here, risky outcome was everyone invest. So now, how does this apply to global games? So what are global games? Global games is a large class of games, so which so main advantage, at least in my opinion, is that they are tractable. And so the fundamentals are summarized by a certain variable theta. So think of theta as being a real variable. You may imagine that theta is multidimensional, but think of it as a real variable. Each player's private information is a noisy observation of theta, so xi, theta plus a noise epsilon. And then, notice that you can define the higher order belief relying on the simple signal xi on fundamentals. Because xi will generate belief about fundamentals, this is what it is made for, but it generates as well belief about other players' beliefs. So given xi, I can consider the law of your signal given the observation of my signal. So this is a second order belief about fundamentals and so on up to infinity. So xi, the only signal xi, allows you to define the whole hierarchy of beliefs at any order. And the main result of global games, will be to consider a coordination game like the investment game, so with multiple equilibria under common knowledge of fundamentals, and then to look at the perturbation of this game, so allowing the lines that I've just emphasized, so a global game perturbation of the game, and to claim that if the perturbation is appropriate, you have a unique equilibrium in the Bayesian game. So you start with a game with multiple outcomes under common knowledge of fundamentals. So a coordination game when there is some coordination problem, and you end up with a game where there is a unique equilibrium, and so where you can better predict the outcome. And this proof will rely of uniqueness, will rely of something I call an infection argument, so an iterative argument. And I will try to make clear the link between the infection argument and the what I've said previously about common p belief. So, first, relax common knowledge of fundamentals. In the above two player investment game, so this is just to rephrase what I've already said, something I already said. So there is a dominance region. This dominance region is the region of fundamentals, where fundamentals are low, so smaller than a certain threshold theta star. So in this region, under common knowledge of theta, not invest is a dominant action. So you have a dominant action somewhere for some values of theta. And the player does not invest if either he believes with large probability, or probability large enough, that theta is low, or if he believes that the other does not invest, even if he puts a large probability on the fact that the fundamentals are high. On the private information, so again, is a noisy signal about theta. Think, so you may use various numbers of distributions, for example, normally distributed variables, or you may think of a uniform distribution of epsilon, or you may think on for theta of a uniform distribution of the whole real line, so an improper prior. So this is not a problem to consider an improper prior because here we are concerned only with conditional distribution, so of distribution of theta conditional to a given xi. But in general, think of a case where the prior of theta will be flat and the noise epsilon e will have a small variance. And consider the fact that the CDF, so the probability that theta is small for a given signal, is increasing in the signal. Yes.
And it's
common out. Yes. So yes, this is a point. Again, as George said yesterday, here we have structural knowledge of a lot of structural knowledge. So the infection argument will rely on the fact that everyone knows in particular the distribution of the signals. And now let's turn attention to the infection argument to show that we have an equilibrium, a unique equilibrium. So this idea of infection argument is to iteratively define the sequence of threshold value on signals, so K0, K1, and so on. So the first point is to say that for small signal, so smaller than some value, say K0, the probability that theta is small is high enough, so it's so high that you just don't want to invest whatever the other does. So you know that when theta is small, you know that not investing is dominant. So here, what I'm just saying is that when you put a large probability of this fact, you don't have to care about what the others does. You know that you don't invest. So this is the first step. The second step is to consider a signal xi which is slightly larger than k0. So it is no longer true that you put a probability high enough on the low fundamentals to directly decide the fact that you don't invest. But what is true now is that you have some knowledge because of the previous step. You have some knowledge about what the other is doing. The knowledge you have is that in case the other, so J, is observing a signal which is smaller than K0, then you know that he's not going to invest. So if you, conditionally of your signal xi, if you put a probability large enough on this fact, so you put a probability large enough on the fact that the other is not investing, then you don't want to invest. And so this will be true for a signal xi, which is say, slightly larger than k0, so between k0 and some value k1. And you can iterate this to infinity. So if you have, the third step will be if you have a signal slightly larger than K1, then you have some information about what the over is doing thanks to the first two steps. So the fact that if the over gets a signal smaller than K1 is not investing, if you put a probability large enough on this, you don't want to invest yourself. And so on up to infinity, so you end up with the conclusion that not investing is the only rational action as long as you see a signal which is smaller than the limit of this sequence Kn. Now, the point is that Kn tends to infinity, so that there is a unique possible rational outcome which is not to invest. So the way I get an intuition about this result is to think of a contradiction. So imagine that the limit of the sequence is finite, k infinity. Think of the marginal player, that is the player observing the marginal signal exactly equal to k infinity. This marginal player should be indifferent between invest and not invest. This is embedded in the fact that k infinity is the limit of this sequence. Now, we want to have a contradiction. So, this marginal player, and this is where you use again the fact that the marginal player knows the law of the distribution of the other signals. And because the noise and the signals are small enough, because the prior is flat enough, my belief about your signal will be that I will put approximately a probability 1/2 on the fact that you observe a signal smaller than k infinity, and so a probability 1/2 on the fact that you observe a signal larger than k infinity. So the point here is that I never think that I am the more optimistic player or that I am the less optimistic player. The reason for the consequence of this is that so you are in a game where if you put probability 1/2 that the over is not investing, so the over having a smaller signal is not investing, that then this is so the fact that I put probability 1/2 on the fact that you are not investing is enough to imply that I strictly want not to invest. So it means that in the payoff of the game, I need to put a probability larger than P to be convinced that I want to invest, and this P must be larger than 1/2. So here, the conclusion is that the marginal player is not indifferent between investing and not investing. He strictly wants not to invest. And so this is a contradiction with the fact that the threshold was finite. And so the threshold is not finite. And the argument that was key, so at least in my understanding of the things here, is that you never think that you are the more optimistic player. If you never think to get a finite threshold here, it must have been the case that the guy with the marginal signal is indifferent. And for the guy with the marginal signal to be indifferent, he must think that the probability that he faces a guy that is not investing, so this guy is a guy with the signal smaller than him, than his signal, this probability is not very large. And so he must think that he's rather more optimistic than most people here. And if now we go back to what I said in the first part about approximate common knowledge, so what we have just concluded is that there is a unique equilibrium where everyone invests does not occur. And we have said previously that this outcome, everyone invests, occurs whenever we have common P belief of the fact that theta is large enough. And the point is that the global game structure, information structure, is such that if you consider any event of the type theta is larger than some threshold, so theta hat, then this event is never common p-belief for a large enough value of p. Why? So just think about the definition of common p-belief. Everyone p believes that theta is larger than something requires that everyone gets a signal that is large enough. Everyone p believes that the first step holds with probability at least p, so that everyone gets a signal that is large enough. It requires that everyone gets a signal which is still higher than this first bound. So the second bound, the second point here, is to say that if I want to p believe that all of you observe a signal which is larger than a certain bound, I need to have myself a signal which is still higher than this bound, so larger than a second bound. And you iterate, and you check exactly as the same, so the argument is the same as on the previous slide. You check that the limit of the of this sequence is infinity, so there is not such domain of signals, so that would be such that if I get a realization of very high signals, theta larger than theta hat will be common p belief. So there is no domain, it is not the case that if xi is larger than some value, some threshold, it will be the case that theta larger than theta hat is common p belief. So what is written here is that the global game structure, so the fact that you put you summarize your fundamentals by a variable theta, and that you define your private information as theta plus a noise, a small noise, this structure is such that it kills every kind of non-trivial common p beliefs. And since what we have said previously is that you need common p-belief of fundamentals to play the risky action at the equilibrium, you have the conclusion that in a global games, you cannot play a risky action at an equilibrium. And just a remark about a well-known global game, so this is just to rephrase this, the previous statement in the speculative attack model of Morris and Shin. So think of my two-player investment game. So just say that you don't invest or not invest, but now you attack a peg or you don't attack a peg. Or to use my words, so the words on the previous slide, say that you may invest or not invest. The equilibrium strategy in the Morris and Shin paper, so the well-known Morris and Shin paper, is that there is a threshold value here, such that you invest if and only if your private signal is larger than this threshold value. So what I just want to point on this slide is that this equilibrium strategy is not in contradiction with what I said previously. The difference in what I said previously and in the 98 Morris and Shin paper is that in the 98 Morris and Shin paper, like in many global games, you have two dominant regions. That is that under common knowledge of theta, you have the dominant region for small theta, you don't want to invest, it is dominant, but you have another dominant region, which is that for large theta, you want to invest. So you are in a game where invest is no longer a risky action, with the meaning that it is no longer an action that you will take only if the other takes it. Sometimes, for high enough fundamentals, you will invest whatever the other does, because it is dominant. And this is and in the intermediate region, so theta between the two thresholds, you get the two, so you have a standard coordination games with two equilibria under common knowledge of fundamentals. What we say now is that to understand the uniqueness result in Morris and Shin, you just apply the infection argument that we have developed, but you apply it twice. You apply it from starting from the two dominant regions. One starting from the high dominant region, so you start on the fact that if you put a high probability, so if you get a signal which is high enough, you put a high probability on the fact that invest is dominant, so you invest. And then you define the sequence of threshold that claims that if you observe a signal which is high enough, you will invest because you put a probability large enough on the fact that others get a high enough private signal to invest themselves. And so you end up with the fact that you want to invest if xi is large enough. You do the same infection argument starting from the law of theta, and you end up with the fact that you want to not to invest if you get a signal which is small enough. So you have two threshold values. Between below the first one, you don't invest. Above the second one, you invest. The question is what happens between the two threshold values. So the two outcomes may be consistent, so maybe equilibrium behavior between the two thresholds. So the unique test results amount to prove that the two thresholds are identical. So there is no region between the two. So note that this equilibrium restores correlation between outcome and fundamentals, so which one of the main points emphasized in the Morrison-Shin equilibrium. So last point about global games, so common knowledge of Frank Belief, so this is something I've already told about. So you have common knowledge of the joint distribution of the fundamental and the signal. So as usual, you have a lot of structural knowledge. And this joint distribution is such that you have common knowledge, so given that you have common knowledge of information structure, you have common knowledge that each agent, when the noise is small, has a uniform belief over the rank of its expectation of theta. So this is what I said before when I said that you never know if you are the more optimistic guy or the less optimistic guy. You are always very uncertain on your position among others, about your degree of optimism. And this is how the infection argument can go through. So my understanding of this is the following. Because you never know that you are, if you are the more optimistic or the less optimistic, you always think that there are a lot of people that are less pessimistic, more pessimistic than you. These pessimistic people, they don't invest. So you always think that there are many people investing. You always think that you are not the more pessimistic guy. So you always think that there are many people more pessimistic than you. The more pessimistic people, they don't invest. So if there are many people not investing, you don't want to invest. This is the basis of the infection argument. Now, if we consider so recent paper about contagious adverse selection, so by Morris and Shin, how you can embed a global game structure in a question of participation into a financial market. So think of coordination question in financial asset markets. This is about the question of adverse selection, so a market where you will have informed-based trading. And there is a coordination problem among uninformed market participants. On a market, you have both informed players and non-informed players. If you are not informed, you know that you may trade. So when you want to trade with someone, you don't know the status of the player in front of you, so you don't know if the other is informed or not, so there is some adverse selection. And you know that you will lose money if you trade with an informed player, so you want to avoid informed-based trading. And so you only want to participate in the market if you think that there is a large enough probability that you will meet non-informed people, so if you think that others are informed in the market. So this is typically a coordination game between uninformed players. They want to participate in the market if and only if others want to participate. On the line of the paper was to interpret the loss of confidence in the interbank markets in 2008 as a coordination failure between between uninformed participants. The idea being, as long as on this market there is approximate common knowledge that there is not too much adverse selection, so that people, when you When you trade assets, we all have more or less the same degree of knowledge about the content of the asset. What they have in mind here, for example, are mortgage-backed securities. So where you have to be aware of the exact value of your asset, you have to make some assessment about the quality of the what is used to back the asset. And so as long as there is approximate common knowledge that there is not too much difference in information about the quality of the asset, there is large participation in the market. And the idea is that the loss of confidence, so the market freeze, is not a consequence of a change in fundamentals, so a possible increase in losses. So not mainly a consequence of this, but maybe it is mainly a consequence of a loss of approximate common knowledge that the losses were small, the expected losses were small. So the fact that the idea here is that the market failure is not due to a change in fundamentals, but is due to a change in higher order belief. So I will come back to this point at on the last slide. So what I want to present here is only the simple version of the model, just to emphasize the idea. So you have bilateral trade environments, you have buyers and sellers of an asset. The idea is that the sellers, every seller owns one unit of the asset. Every buyer has a unit demand, so you will only the trade between a buyer and a seller is simple. The seller gives the unit to the buyer, and that's it. And the value is differently to allow for trades for the ex-ante allocation of the asset is not pareto optimal, so there is a motif for trade. So the seller value it at V minus C, the buyer at V plus C. So there is a pareto gain for everyone to give the asset from the seller to the buyer. So si the parameter C here is common knowledge, so it is common knowledge that there are gains from trade. What is not common knowledge is the value of V, which is stochastic, so V bar plus a noise, and the noise can take three values, negative one, zero, or a positive one, with probability, so small probability delta and a large probability 1 minus 2 delta to keep the thing equal to zero. So call the asset a lemon when epsilon is negative, normal when epsilon is zero, and a peach when epsilon is good. Add adverse selection to the model. So now assume that only k buyers and k sellers observe this. The others have no prior information about this. And so Q is, so the ratio k over n is, so a measure of adverse selection, it is the probability, so for n large enough, it is the probability that you, if you are uninformed, the probability that you you will meet uninformed, yes, player. So if I am an uninformed seller, if I am match randomly with a buyers, the probability that I meet an informed guy is Q. The probability that I meet a non-informed guy is 1 minus Q. So here, the trading mechanism is simple because this is probably a terrible thing for an economist, but the price will be exogenous. And so the matching process is simply you match people and you ask them if they want to trade or not. So they just say that they want to trade or not, and the trade occurs when they both say yes. So to understand the logic of the game, first note that informed agents have a dominant strategy. So an informed buyer, given that the price is exogenous, an informed buyer will say yes to trade whenever he knows that he is buying a normal asset or a pitch asset, and no otherwise. So if the asset is a lemon. So all the units of the asset have the same property. And there is an analogous behavior for the informed sellers. But there is a coordination problem for uninformed since their behavior depends on who they think they face. So we will first look at the case where the environment is common knowledge, and then the case where the fundamentals is relaxed. So the reduced form of the model, so the reason for which the model is the example is a smart example, is that you can summarize all that you need to know about the fundamentals by just one single parameter, which is a loss ratio. So the problem, the coordination problem, is for the uninformed guy. So the what happens to an uninformed, for example, an uninformed seller? He's matched with a buyer, and the buyer will buy unless he's informed that the asset is a lemon. So you can compute the expected gain of the uninformed seller if he agrees on trading. So when faced with an uninformed buyer with a probability Q, he knows that he will lose money, so you are uninformed, so you lose if you trade with an informed guy. And the expected losses, so you can compute them. So with a probability 1 minus 2 delta, you the informed guy knows that the asset is normal. And with a probability delta, you know that you trade with a buyer who knows that the asset is a pitch, so you lose money because you sell the asset at a price lower than its value. And so it gives you this value. Now, when you are faced with an uninformed buyer, which occurs with probability 1 minus Q, the expected gains are C because the guy is not informed. And so you can consider the loss ratio, which is the ratio between what your expected loss when if you face an informed buyer and the expected gain if you face an uninformed buyer. So this is what you face, this loss ratio, so this is the best situation you can face because this is your loss ratio if you agree on trade. So if all the others uninformed are trading. So what is implicit here is that if you consider that the uninformed buyer has an occurrence 1 minus Q, which is a Exogenous proportion of uninformed people, it means that you consider that all of them will accept to trade. Okay, you meet someone, this someone tells you I want to trade, I agree on trading. Here, this is the values if everyone agrees on trading. So it is the smallest possible values of the loss ratio if you are in a world where all the uninformed will, or a large proportion of the uninformed will not agree on trading, then the probability of making gains when trading with uninformed will be smaller, and so this ratio should be higher. And so one very common knowledge of loss ratio, so common knowledge of parameters, the idea here is that if the loss ratio is high enough, so larger than one, then there is a unique equilibrium where no one trades. And if psi is smaller, there is also an equilibrium where everyone trades. So the idea here is that if psi is larger than one, the uninformed guy knows that even in a world where every uninformed trades, which is a world which is the most favorable to him, in this case, he will have psi larger than one. It means that in average, he makes more losses than gain. And so he does not want to trade. So in the best possible world, he's making losses, so he does not want to trade. Now, if you are in this other world, if psi is smaller than one, so again, there is the equilibrium where no one trades, because if I am in a world where no uninformed trades, I am uninformed, I know that if I meet someone who says, okay, let's trade, this someone is informed, so I will make losses against him, so I don't want to trade. So this is equilibrium behavior, not to trade. Now the point here is that psi is small, so there is another equilibrium. Again, imagine that I am an uninformed agent, that I face someone who accepts to trade. If I am in a world where everyone agrees on trading, then the ratio between my expected losses and gains will be exactly the psi. and it will be the case that I make more gains, expected gains, well, than expected losses. So, expected, so the probability of meeting an uninformed is high enough for me to agree on trading. So, a coordination games. Here, so what we have is the same reduced form as my two-player investment game. You have a parameter psi. Psi, if it's high enough, there is a unique outcome. If it's low, there are two possible equilibrium outcomes, so there is a coordination problem. And the point is that we can use the global game story to... Yes, because if no one trades, so I'm not sure of the answer to the question, but I am not sure of the answer to the question, but what I'm thinking of is that if no one trades, even the informed will have a gain from trading. So the informed, they have an incentive to reveal their information to allow for some kind of trading. But at this stage, you will have a coordinate.
Why is that not being considered? There's one more avenue.
Because it will move the coordination problem. Because it will. Okay, so let's assume that we have a point here, that it is the case that when no one trades, there is an incentive for informed to reveal the information. But now I believe that there is a coordination problem among informed traders. Because they want that trade occurs, so for this they need that the information is more diffused. So the, but probably they don't want to reveal their information. They prefer that others reveal it. So I'm not sure of what I say.
The game will change, I'm sure.
Yes.
But it should be in a long time.
Mm. No, you're right, there is a point
here. After a disaster, maybe you will get the government in the
end. Yes, so in case of a disaster, there is room for cooperation because there is a need for information revelation. So, but this point is not embedded in the model. So now imagine that common knowledge, so no longer common knowledge of psi. And before we define the global game, just a remark about the behavior of the model in this case. Suppose that a seller doesn't know any longer the proportion of uninformed buyers, so call this proportion pi, and is uncertain of the parameters, m. So when will he accept to trade? So again, you compute the expected gain to trade of an informed seller, conditional on pi. So you so don't look at the algebra, but you just say that there is a certain probability that he meets an uninformed trading, a certain probability that he meets an uninformed not trading, and so on. And you end up with the conclusion that it is optimal to trade if and only if his expectation of psi is smaller than his expectation of pi. Pi again is the probability that the others uninformed players participate into the market. So it's optimal to trade, so this inequality makes sense when your loss ratio, your belief on your loss ratio is smaller than your belief of how many uninformed participate in the market. So you want to participate in the market when your loss ratio is small and when everyone, so many people participate in the market. Same idea as previously. So symmetric analysis for the buyer. Now we can define more specifically the information structure. And how we define more? How do we define more specifically the information structure? We do it using a global game. And so the idea is to get a game where the information structure is such that this property that drives the fact that uninformed trades will not be enough approximate common knowledge. And so there will be no trade at equilibrium. And so you consider a random parameter theta distributed, for example, uniformly on the real line. Take a simple example where psi, this is really only an example, psi can take two values, a high one, so a bad one. This is the case when theta is small. And a lower value lower than one, so a good value, good for trade, when theta is high. So again, for small, so theta is the fundamental. For small theta, we are in a bad world where no trade is dominant. And for large theta, we are in a world where trade is possible, but not the only possible outcome. Imagine now that you have the private information that, which is that every guy plays a signal, so gets a signal which is a noisy observation of theta. So epsilon I is so the unit normal distribution. Sigma is just a positive real parameter for to define the variance of the noise. And just think of the fact that your expectation on psi is decreasing in xi. So the larger your signal, the smaller psi, so the smaller your belief on psi, meaning the larger your signal, the more optimistic you are on the possibility of trading. If you get a small signal, it will be dominant for you not to trade. If you get a high signal, at this stage, you are still wondering whether the others will trade or not. If they will trade, you will agree on trading. And the question is now to understand if it will be the case that you will be in a position to understand that the others are trading. And so now, global game story as usual. So now we are back to the infection argument. So to read the infection argument, just recall that the uninformed agent trades when his belief on the others participating in the market is more larger than his belief on psi. So, and so first step, for small signal, what I've just said, for small signal, you just don't trade, this is dominant, you don't have to care about what others do because you put a so large probability on the fact that psi is large, that your belief on psi is larger than one, so it can never be the case that you think that there is a probability, so it can never be the case that your belief on pi is larger than your belief on psi. And so now iterate. Imagine that you are you get a signal which is slightly larger than K0. Then you have an expectation of psi which is slightly smaller than one. But now you have some knowledge about what others are doing. You know that people which are pessimistic, so people with small signals, they will not trade. So you know that the maximum probability of uninformed trading corresponds to the situation where every people with larger signal trade, which is a more optimistic case for you. And if you are in a situation where, even in this case, where all the people with a signal larger than K0, they trade, but this is still not enough because this is still smaller than your belief on psi. If you are in this case, you just don't want to trade. And this occurs whenever your signal is say slightly larger than K0, but not too larger, so say smaller than K1. So the conclusion of state 2 is that you don't trade when you get a signal smaller than K1, and so you iterate up to infinity. And so the same argument as in my two player investment games, so I have rewritten the argument, but I've already told about this. The result is that the limit of the sequence will be infinite. So you end up with a unique equilibrium where no one trade because there is not such an interval of signals where you decide to trade if you observe these signals. And the intuition for the fact that the threshold, so the limit threshold is infinity, again, relies, so my understanding of this relies on looking at the marginal agent. Imagine that the marginal agent, so the guy observing the limit signals, so we first assume that the result is not correct, assume that the limit signal is finite. So there is a marginal agent observing the limit signal, and this marginal agent must be indifferent between trading and not trading. So it must be the case that indifference is this, must be the case that my belief on psi is exactly my belief on the proportion of others participating in the market. But the point is that because of the information structure, so I am not the less pessimistic agent, I am not the more pessimistic agent. So, sorry, I think that I am not the more pessimistic agent, that I am not the less pessimistic agent. I think when I get my signal that I am an average guy. Half of the people, so on the other side of the market, so the sellers, if I'm a buyer, half of the people on the other side of the market, they get signals slower than me. And the people with signals slower than me, they don't participate. So my my expectation of the proportion of people participating is just one half. And the example has been done such that the possible value of psi, if you go back to the previous slide, you have two possible values of psi. Both are strictly larger than one half. So my expectation of psi is always strictly larger than one half, can never be equal to one half. So there is a contradiction. I cannot be indifferent between participating or not. So the standard marginal marginal adjunct argument. And this, you can rephrase it on using approximate common knowledge. So in a logic that follows the logic of the previous part, the first part of this talk today, is that we have said that an informed adjunct is willing to participate in the market if and only if he thinks that his expectation on psi is small enough. So a first necessary condition is that it is smaller than one. Then a second necessary condition will be that it is, so one is true, and his expectation on pi, so of the proportion of adjunct participating, so for whom one is small enough, is true, and it is greater than expectation psi on the loss ratio. And so you can iterate on this, and assuming at every step one more degree in beliefs. So my expectation of the proportion of people for whom the previous step is correct is greater than their expectation of the loss ratio and so on up to infinity. And the point here is that if you put all these properties together, you get the fact that it may be commonly p believed, so it may be enough common knowledge that everyone is expecting a loss ratio which is smaller than the proportion of others for which. So it is approximately common knowledge that psi, so the, my belief on psi will be smaller than my belief on pi, so meaning that it may be, if I am in these circumstances, I agree on participating on the market, and so it is approximate common knowledge that I will participate in the market, and so that everyone will participate on the market. And this is what they call market confidence, if it is the case that there is approximate common knowledge enough, so that all this is true. And this is my last slide before conclusion. And so just to come back to the example, so the little story I told to motivate the paper, so the idea of the role of higher order belief when losing market confidence. So imagine a situation where first you have common knowledge that the loss ratio, that the fundamentals are bad, so psi is equal to psi L. In this case, there is only an equilibrium, There is common knowledge that the fundamentals are good. Sorry, fundamentals are high. I'm confusing. Good fundamentals here corresponds to a low value of psi. So imagine that, in addition, that we are in a situation where we are at the equilibrium where all uninformed trade. Now imagine that you have a shock, not a shock on fundamentals, a shock on beliefs. So add some sigma. Sigma is a parameter on the noise. So now consider that there is no longer common knowledge on psi. Now there is an approximate common there is a private information on psi, which is my private information is a noisy observation of signal with a variant sigma square. Psi does not change. In this case, we have shown that there is a unique equilibrium where no trade, where there is no trade, so by an informed agent. And so, the idea is that just decreasing the degree of common knowledge on the fundamentals creates a disaster. And so just to conclude, to summarize briefly what I've tried to tell you today, is that first, coordination and risky action occurs when there is enough common knowledge that the fundamentals are consistent with the fact that playing the risky action is optimal. Then, it was part two, global game is just an information structure that prevents that there is too much common knowledge. The very important advantage of global game is that it is a very well-behaved information structure, so very easy to handle. And in the third part, we had a benchmark model of an adverse selection-driven coordination problems. And that's it. Thank you.